No, no, Flaherty, none of that now. You're off duty. Remember, though I am a general of 40 years' service, that little course of yours gives you a higher rank in the roll of glory than I can pretend to.
Well, I'm thankful to you, Sir Pierce, but I wouldn't have anyone think that the Baronet of my native place would let a common soldier like me sit down in his presence without leave.
Well, you're not a common soldier, O'Flaherty. You're a very uncommon one, and I'm proud to have you for my guest here today.
Sure I know, sir. All the quality shakes hands with me, says they're proud to know me. Just the way the King said, when he pinned the cross on me. And it's as true as I'm standing here, sir, that the Queen said to me, I hear you were born on the estate of General Madigan, she says, and the General himself tells me you were always a fine young fellow. But Dad, ma'am, I says to her, if the General knew all the rabbits I'd snared on him, and all the salmon I'd snatched on him, and all the cows I'd milked on him, he'd think me the finest ornament for the county jail he'd ever sent there for poaching.
Well, you're welcome to them all, my lad. Come, sit down and enjoy your holiday.
Holiday? Is it? I give 5 shillings to be back in the trenches for the sake of a little rest and quiet. I never knew what hard work was till I took to the recruiting. What was standing on my legs all day and shaking hands and making speeches? And what's worse, listening to them and calling for cheers for king and country and saluting the flag till I'm stiffed and listening to them playing God Save the King in Tipperary and trying to make my eyes look moist like some man in a picture book. I'm that bent that I can hardly get a wink of sleep. I give you my word, Sir Pierce, that I never heard that tune of Tipperary in my life until I returned from Flanders. And already, it's drove me to the pitch of tiredness of it that when a poor innocent slip of a boy in the street the other night drew himself up and saluted and began whistling it at me, I clouted his head for him. God forgive me.
Yes, I know. One does get fed up with it. I've been so hard on prey myself many a time. But still, you know, there's a gratifying side to it too. After all, he's our king, and it's our own country, isn't it?
Well, sir, to you that having a stay in it, it would feel like your country. But the divil a perch I ever owned of it. And as to the king, God help him. My mother would have taken the skin off my back if I'd ever let on to any other king than Parnell.
Your mother? What are you dreaming of, O'Father? The most loyal woman, always most loyal. Whenever there is an illness in the royal family, she asks me every time we meet about the health of the patient, as anxiously as if it were yourself, her only son.
Well, she's my mother, and I won't utter a word again her. But I'm not telling you a word of a lie when I say that old woman is the biggest knack from here to the Cross of Monaster Boys. Sure, she's the wildest fiend and rebel, and always has been. That ever taught a poor innocent boy like myself to pray night and morning to St. Patrick to clear the English out of Ireland the same as he cleared the snakes. You'll be surprised maybe now at my telling you that, Sir Pierce.
Surprised? I'm more than surprised, O'Flaherty. I'm overwhelmed. Are you joking?
You've been brought up by my mother, sir. You'd know better than to joke about it. But I'm telling you the truth. I wouldn't tell it to you. I can see my way of getting out of the fix I'd be in. And my mother comes here this day to see her boy in all his glory. And she after thinking all the time it was against the English I was fighting for.
You mean to say you told her such a monstrous falsehood? It's that you were fighting in the German army.
I never told her one word that wasn't the truth and nothing but the truth. I told her I was going to fight for the French and for the Russians. And sure, whoever heard of the French or the Russians doing anything to the English for fighting them. That is how it was, sir. And sure, the poor woman kissed me and went about the house singing in her old cracky voice that the French was on the sea and they'd be here without delay and the orange will decay. Says the Shan Van Buck.
Well, I never would have believed it. Never. What do you suppose will happen when she finds out?
Well, she mustn't find out. It's not that she'd half kill me, as big as I am and as brave as I am. It's that I'm fond of her. I can't bring myself to break the heart in her. You may think it queer, sir, that a man should be fond of his mother. She after having bet him from the time he could feel until the time she was too slow to catch him. But I am fond of her. And I'm not ashamed of it. Besides, didn't she win the cross for me?
Your mother? How?
Well, by bringing me up to be more afraid of running away than of fighting. I was timid by nature, and when the other boys hurted me, I'd want to run away and cry. But she wailed me for disgracing the blood of the O'Flahertys until I'd have fought the devil himself sooner than facing her after funking a fight. That is how I got to know that fighting is easier than it looks, sir. And the others is as much afeard of me as I was of them. And that if only I held out long enough, they'd lose heart and give rip. That is how I became so courageous. I give you my word, Sir Pierce. If the German army had been brought up by my mother, the Kaiser himself would be dining in the banqueting hall in Buckingham Palace this day. And King George polishing his jack boots from in the scullery.
But I don't like you, O'Flaherty. You can't go on deceiving your mother, no. Not right.
Can't go on deceiving her. But it's if you know what a son's love can do, sir. Did you ever notice what a ready liar I am?
Well, in recruiting, a man gets carried away. I expect to do it occasionally myself, after all, for kingdom country. But if you won't mind my saying it, O'Flaherty, that story about your fighting the Kaiser and the 12 giants of the Prussian Guard single-handed would be the better of a little Tony Guard. I don't ask you to drop it, you know, or it's proper and out of there, but still the truth is the truth. Don't you think it affected almost as many recruits? It's the number of guards we do check.
You're just not used to telling lies like I am, sir. I got great practice at home with my mother. What with saving my skin when I was young and thoughtless, and sparing her feelings when I was old enough to understand them. I've had to tell my mother the truth twice a year since I was born. And you'd have me turn around and tell it to her now, when she's looking to have some peace and quiet in her old age.
Well, it's not my affair, of course, O'Flaherty, but hadn't you better talk to Father Quinlan?
Talk to Father Quinlan, is it? Do you know what Father Quinlan says to me this very morning?
Well, you've seen him already, have you? What did he say?
He says, you know, don't you, he says, that it's your duty as a Christian and a good son of the Holy Church to love your enemies, he says. I know it's my duty as a soldier to kill them, I says. Well, that's right, Ginny, he says, quite right. But, says he, you can kill them and do them a good turn afterwards to show your love, he says. And it's your duty to have a mass said for the souls of the hundreds of Germans you say you kill, says he. For many and many of them were Bavarians and good Catholics, he says. And is it me that must pay for the masses for the souls of the Boches, I says. Let the King of England pay for them. It's his quarrel, not mine.
It is the quarrel of every honest man and true patriot, O'Flaherty. Your mother must see that as clearly as I do. After all, she's a reasonable, well-disposed woman, quite capable of understanding the right and the wrong of the war. Why can't you explain to her what the war is about?
Her, sir. What the devil would I know what the war is about?
What? Oh, Faraday, you know what you're saying? You sit there wearing the Victoria of war, but killing broad those coming Germans. You tell me you don't know why you did it.
I'm begging your pardon now, Sir Pierce. Can I tell you more quickly? I know quite well why you did that. Because, well, I was afraid that if I didn't, they'd kill me.
Have you not learned of the causes of war, of the interests of state, of the importance? You may say, yes, I will say, of the sanctity of the right for which they are fighting. Don't you be the traitor?
Well, I do when I can get them. There aren't many newsboys crying an evening paper in the trenches. They do say, Sir Pierce, that we shall never truly beat the Boches until we make Horatio Bottomley Lord Lieutenant of England. Do you think that's true, sir?
Rubbish, man! There's no Lord Lieutenant in England. The King's Lord Lieutenant. It's just some full question of patriotism. Patriotism means nothing to you.
Well, it means different to me than what it does to you, sir. It means England and England's king to you. But to me, and the like of me, it means talking about the English the way the English papers talk about the Boches. And sure, what good has it ever done here in Ireland? It kept me ignorant, because it filled up my mother's mind, and she thought it ought to fill up mine too. It kept Ireland poor, because instead of trying to better ourselves, we thought, oh, we's the fine fellows of patriots speaking evil of Englishmen. That was as good as ourselves, and as poor as ourselves. The Boches I killed was more knowledgeable men than me. And what better am I now that I've killed them? What better is anybody?
I'm sorry for the terrible experience of this war. The greatest war ever fought. This taught you no better, Professor.
Well, I don't know about it being a great war, sir. It's a big war. But that's not the same thing. Father Quinlan's new church is a big church. You might take the little old chapel right over the middle, but not miss it. My mother says there was more true religion in the old chapel. And this war has taught me that maybe she was right, sir. And there's another thing it's taught me too, sir, that concerns you and me, if I may make bold to tell it to you.
I hope it's nothing important to say
to me. Well, it's this, sir, that I'm able to sit here now and talk to you without humbling you. And that's something that not one of your tenants or your tenants' children ever did to you before in all your long life. It's a true respect I'm showing you at last, sir. Maybe you'd rather have me humbug you and tell you lies as I used, just as the boys here, God help them, would rather have me tell them how I fought the Kaiser, that all the world knows I never saw him in life, than tell them the truth. But I can't take advantage of you the way I used, sir. Not even if I seem wanting in respect or cocked up by winning the cross.
Not at all.
Sure. What's the cross to me, barring the little pension it carries? Do you think I don't know that there's hundreds of men as brave as me that never had the luck to get anything for their bravery except a curse from their sergeants and the blame for them that ought to have been their betters? I've learnt more than you think, sir. But sure, how would a gentleman like you know what a poor, ignorant, conceited creature I was when I went from here into the wide world as a soldier? What use is all the lying and pretending and humbugging and letting on when the day comes to you that your comrade is killed in the trench beside you and you don't as much as turn around to look at him until you trip over his poor body? And then all you say is to ask, why the hell the stretcher bearers don't take him out of the way? Why should I read papers to be lied to and humbugged by them that had the cunning to stay at home and send me off to fight for them?
No, what you did was brave and manly.
God knows whether it was better than you nor me, General. I hope you won't be too hard on me for anyone.
Oh, yes. lonely to think seriously sometimes, especially when we're a little unwell. I'm afraid we've been overworking you a bit over the recruiting meetings. Still, we can lock it off for the rest of the day and tomorrow or Sunday. At about as much as I can stand myself. It's tea time. I wonder what's keeping your mother.
It's nicely cocked up. The old woman will be having tea at the same table as you, sir, instead of in the kitchen. She'll be after dressing in the height of grandeur. Stop she will at every house along the way to show herself off and tell them where she's going. I'll fill the whole parish full of spite and envy. But she wouldn't keep you waiting.
Oh, that's all right. She must be indulged on an occasion like this. I'm sorry my wife is in London. She would have been glad to welcome you.
Sure, I know she would, sir. She was always a kind friend to the poor. Little her ladyship knew the depth of divinity that was in us. We was like a play to her. You see, sir, she was English. That was how it was. We was to her what the pagans and the Senegalese was to me when I first saw them. I couldn't think somehow that they were liars and thieves and backbiters and drunkards like ourselves or any other Christians. Her ladyship never knew all that was going on behind her back. How would she? When I was a wee she child, she gave me the first penny I ever had in my hand. And I wanted to pray for her conversion. That night, the same as my mother had made me pray for yours, and it...
You mean to say your mother made you pray for my conversion?
Well, sure, she wouldn't want to see a gentleman like you go to hell. After she nursing your own son and bringing up my sister Annie on the bottom. That was how it was, sir. She'd rob you, and she'd lie to you, and then she'd call down all the blessings of God on your head while she was selling you your own three geese that you thought had been ate by the fox the day after you finished battling them, sir. And all the time, you were like a bit of her own flesh and blood for you. Often, as she said, she'd live to see you a good Catholic yet, leading victorious armies against the English and wearing the collar of gold that Malachy won from the proud invader.
Look, I really can't believe the whole happened. I could have sworn your mother was the honest woman that ever breathed.
A socialist, sir.
You called it honest to steal my keys?
Right. She didn't steal them. It was me that stole them.
Why the devil did you steal them?
Well, so we needed them. Often and often we had to sell our own geese to pay you the rent, to satisfy your needs. And why should we sell yours to satisfy ours? Sure. You had to get what you cut out of us and we had to get what we cut out of you. God forgive us all.
Really, O'Brady. The war seems to have upset you.
Set me thinking, sir. And I'm not used to it. It's like the patriotism of the English. They never thought of being patriotic until the war broke out. And now the patriotism has took them so sudden and come so strange to them that they run about like frightened chickens uttering all manner of nonsense. Ah, but please God, they'll forget about it all when the war is over. I think they're getting tired of it already.
No, it has afflicted us all in a wonderful way. The world will never be the same again, O'Fahate. Not after a war like this.
But so they all say, sir. I see no great fear for myself. It's all this fright and excitement. And when that dies down, they'll go back to their natural dimness and be the same as ever. It's like the vermin, it'll wash off after a while.
Well, the longer and the shorter it is, O'Fahate, I must decline to be a part of it. To any attempt to deceive your mother. I thoroughly disapprove of this feeling against the English, especially at a moment like the present. Even if your mother's political sympathies are as you represent them to be, I should think that her practical deception could cure her of any such disloyal tendencies.
She says Gladstone was an Irishman, sir. What cause would he have to meddle with Ireland as he did if he wasn't?
What nonsense does she suppose Mr. Asquith is an Irishman?
But she won't give him any credit for home rule, sir. She says Redmond made him do it and that you told her so.
Good luck! I never meant to take it up in that ridiculous way. Oh, I shall give a good talk to her when she comes. I'm not going to stand any of her, no?
It's not a bit of use, sir. She says all the English generals is Irish. She says all the English poets and great men is Irish.
Oh?
She says the English never knew how to read their own books until we taught them. She says that we're the last tribes of the House of Israel and the chosen people of God. She says that the goddess Venus that was born out of the foam of the sea came up out of the water of Pliny Day off Bray Head. She says that Moses built the seven churches. And that Lazarus is buried in Glasnevin.
Gosh! How is she buried after you're after?
Well, I did, sir, after.
What did she say?
She said, how did I know he wasn't? He fetched me a clout to the side of my head.
But have you never mentioned any famous English people and asked what you had to say about him?
Well, the only one I could think of, sir, was Shakespeare.